Good morning and welcome to Sharan's talk today, Meat, Protein and COVID-19. Is there any connection? That's what we're going to spend this morning discovering. Is there any connection? And what is the effect of meat on many different aspects of our life where we are directly and indirectly connected? Why have we decided to take up this topic today? Because 4th of July is Independence from Meat Day. And it started in a country called USA, where a lot of people consume meat. And they have started a day, Independence from Meat Day. And they have discovered some things which we are going to be sharing with you today. So thank you very much for coming and for being open to learning and understanding actual things that we all should be aware of. And then, of course, it's always our choice. So without much further ado, let's start today's session. I would like to invite our first guest today. It's Shalu, who is our whole food plant-based nutritionist. And she was somebody who used to enjoy having her meat. But then something happened in life and she decided to make a shift. And after she made a shift, she found out a lot of things. And this is all that she's going to be sharing with us today. So may I invite Shalu?
Thank you, Rena.
Thank you.
So, hello. Good morning, everyone. And yes, I used to consume a lot of meat and I used to consume everything from chicken to pork to beef. And I've even tried baby octopuses. And something happened in my life. It was my husband's autoimmune disorder, which actually changed my whole perception, and it changed the way I look at food now. My husband was suffering from ankylosing spondylitis, which is an autoimmune disorder, and he was having a lot of pain and stiffness in his back, for which he was taking painkillers and steroids every day, just so that he's able to sit, stand, and, you know, walk. None of the doctors were able to help him. So we were looking for alternatives and we came across Sharan. I attended a couple of seminars with Dr. Nandita, where she explained very nicely why it is important that we eliminate meat and dairy from our lives. So we made the shift immediately, and in 3 months, his pain and stiffness was gone. He was even diabetic, so that was also gone. And he was not taking any more pills. He wasn't taking any painkillers or steroids. And that was such a beautiful change in our lives that I thought of educating myself more on this and sharing my journey and my experience with as many people as possible. So that's what I'm going to try and do today. I'll just start my screen share. I hope you can all see it.
Yes, we can, Shan.
Okay. So before I start, I would just like to ask all of you, if you consume meat or if you have consumed meat before, what is the reason that we humans consume meat of other animals? What is the primary reason that we consume meat? If you could please type it in the chat box.
Okay, Shalu, we have Usha who talks about taste. We have some answers of protein.
Okay.
And somebody is saying that we always thought that it's normal. I mean, we never really thought about it.
Yeah, right. So the
habit is another one.
Habit, correct. That's like conditioning. We've been conditioned to think that it's good for us or it's okay to eat it, right?
Raghav says, I was introduced by my parents. Prashanti says we've been given by family.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because they also never gave it much thought, and they also thought that they're doing the right thing by giving you meat because they thought it's healthy and it has a lot of protein in it, right? So protein and taste are the two more important reasons. Of course, there are other reasons, but the primary reasons why most of us feel it's okay to consume meat is because either we think that, you know, it has a lot of protein, so it's good for us, or we like the taste of it. So let's have a look at both of these in a little bit of detail. So when we talk of protein, protein is really important for us. We need it. It's the food for growth and repair. But how much do we really need? I don't know anybody who's had a protein deficiency, but I know a lot of people who have kidney issues or liver issues, which are somehow related to excess protein intake, right? So how much do we need, and why is too much protein bad for us? So there are a lot of researches done on this topic, but I'll just share one research with you. It was done by a university in Greece, and they studied the effects of long-term high animal protein intake in humans. And they found that when we are consuming a lot of meat, it results in loss of bone density. So our bodies are alkaline, right? But animal protein is really, really acidic. So when we consume excess of animal protein, calcium needs to be leached out of our bones in order to bring it to the alkaline level of our body. And that results in diseases like osteoporosis, arthritis, and other joint pain issues. So this animal protein, which we are thinking is good for us, is actually draining our calcium away, right? And now, even it's really hard on our kidneys to excrete the byproducts of animal protein metabolism. And so we end up having kidney disorders. And then it's also difficult for the liver to cleanse our body of all these byproducts that animal protein creates. And meat intake is one of the leading causes of non-alcoholic fatty liver disorder, which is really common these days. Animal protein intake is also connected with a lot of cancers and how it increases the cancer risk. And then because meat is so high in cholesterol and saturated fat, it also increases the rate at which the coronary artery disease progresses. So it's also connected to that. So these are all the issues that we start having when we consume a lot of meat over a long period of time. So there are plants from where we get our proteins. So if we want to avoid all these issues that animal protein gives us, we stop consuming meat and we shift to plant-based proteins, which are the first-hand sources of protein. How do animals get their protein? They get it from plants, right? So why not we just take in the first-hand source of protein straight away from plants, plants are also very nutrient-dense foods. They are high in phytonutrients, and they are so good for us. So if we are consuming fruits, vegetables, legumes, grains, nuts, and seeds, we are getting enough protein that our body needs without all the other risks of diseases. So we can have tofu, we can have chickpeas and peanuts, nuts, seeds, all these are very high in protein. And I'm sure you recognize these people. They are the top sports people in the world today. And you know, two things are common amongst all of them. Number one, they are the best in their sport in the world. And number two is that they are all vegan. So if they are able to get all their protein from plant-based sources, there's no reason why we should be resorting to meat for our protein, right? Also, we have to understand that we are not designed to eat meat. Our digestive tract is much longer than that of a carnivore, and it's much similar to herbivores. It's very long. So we have been designed in a way that we are able to digest plant-based foods much better than meat. Also, when we look at our teeth, it's very similar to that of herbivores, and our teeth are not like carnivores. We don't have canines so that we can just jump on an animal, bite into it and tear it apart with our teeth and just, you know, devour it raw. We can't do that because our teeth are not designed to do so. So all the people who I just showed you, these sports people, you know, they're doing so good because they are actually following their instincts and they're doing, they're putting the right fuel in their body by understanding how Mother Nature has designed everything. And these are the reasons why we should not be consuming meat, because it's not instinctual. Like when we see an animal walking by, we don't feel like eating it. But if we see an apple hanging from a tree or a mango or lychees, you know, we really feel like biting into them and eating. So that is our natural instinct. So we need to start following our natural instincts, and that is how we are going to gain optimum health. Also, high protein should be the reason for not consuming meat and not the reason for consuming meat, because we don't need so much of protein and it causes a lot of diseases, as we saw. It has a lot of saturated fat. Meat has a lot of saturated fat, which is not good for our heart health. There is no fiber in meat. Fiber is really valuable for us because it cleans our body. It removes the toxins. It keeps us fuller for longer, so we don't overeat and we don't gain weight. But when we are consuming meat, we always tend to overeat. Whenever we go out and we consume any non-veg, you know, we tend to overeat because there's no fiber in it. So we need to consume more fiber-rich foods, which are all plant-based foods. It is very acidic, as we already discussed. There is a lot of cholesterol. And do you know, none of the plant-based foods have any cholesterol. Plants don't make cholesterol. But animal foods are very high in cholesterol, which result in blocking of our blood vessels. It might cause stroke or other heart issues. Meat is also high in antibiotics. And that is because animals in farms are constantly given antibiotics through their feed or through injections so that they don't get infections, because they are kept in such horrific conditions. They have so many injuries and it's really difficult to avoid infections without antibiotics. So if we keep consuming meat throughout our life, we are constantly taking in small doses of antibiotics. And if we fall sick and we really need an antibiotic, then our body becomes resistant to it. That is what is happening to most people who are dying of easily treatable diseases because they have antibiotic resistance. So antibiotics, which can be life-saving, are actually not able to help us because of the constant small doses of intake that we are doing. Then there are growth hormones, which are injected to animals so that they grow faster and at a much, and they grow bigger so that the profit of the farmer increases. And then when we are consuming meat, we are taking in all these growth hormones, which our body doesn't need. Our body has its own hormones, its own hormonal balance, which is affected when we are consuming all these external hormones. And then we end up having diseases like thyroid and PCOD, and even type 2 diabetes. There are stress hormones in meat. And you know, animals who are kept in farms, they know that they are going to be killed because they are seeing their family members being killed right in front of their eyes. They know they are next in line. They are in so much of stress because they are kept in small cages. And, you know, their adrenaline is at its peak when we slaughter them. And then we consume them, taking in all these stress hormones. And it causes mental issues like depression, anxiety, and stress. And we are all seeing that how common it is these days, right? Meat is also associated with different types of cancers. And we know a lot of research has been done that meat promotes cancer. It also increases inflammation. And I have seen this in my husband's case. When he was consuming meat, he was having more inflammation and he was having more pain. But the moment he stopped consuming meat, his inflammation and pain went away. Also, meat reduces our immunity because of a lot of free radicals. So we know how important our immunity is for us in this current scenario, and we don't want to compromise on it at all. So these are reasons good enough for us to understand why meat is so bad for our health and why we should avoid it. So why were we consuming meat? There were two reasons, protein and taste. We've had a look at protein and we know that we don't need it anymore from meat. Now let's have a look at taste. So many people enjoy the taste of meat. They feel that they enjoy the taste of meat. But you know what? It's not the taste of meat that we enjoy. We add so many spices, which are all plant-based. We add so many vegetables. We add so many herbs to the meat to actually make it tempting for us. And we don't realize that, you know, it's not at the actual taste of meat that we are enjoying, but the taste of all these spices, beautiful plant-based spices and herbs that we are adding, which is actually boosting the taste. If we had to eat raw meat, would we enjoy the taste of it? No, right? That means it is not designed for us to eat because we can't eat it in the natural form. In order to make it edible and tempting, we need to add so many plant-based foods to it, right? But even if you really want that taste, you know, there are plant-based mock meats available now. There are plant-based egg alternatives available in the market now. So we can resort to that. But the most important thing that we need to understand is that nothing tastes as good as healthy feels. So we need to set our priorities right. We need to understand our health is more important than our taste. And people in the United States are realizing it. They have been consuming more plant-based meats in March and April this year as compared to animal-based meats. So this change is coming and now it's our turn. We need to decide if we want to embrace this change, which is going to make our health so much better. And if you see, these are some plant-based foods from one of our classes and they look so tempting, they look so nice and they are very delicious. So if we can get all this from plant-based sources, why should we go and kill somebody and consume a dead body, right? So now we know that we don't need meat for protein or for the taste. We have other beautiful sources for all this, right? Now, one more reason is there why we should not be consuming meat, which is really relevant at this time, is that meat causes pandemics. We are seeing one and we are seeing the devastation it is causing. So most deadly viruses that humankind has seen in recent times has come from animals. And it has not come from animals, but it has come from the exploitation of animals for their meat or for their body parts by humans. So if you look at a mad cow disease or swine flu or SARS or bird flu, they are all coming from these farmed animals who are kept in close confinement and being abused constantly day by day. They are just being abused for their meat or for their body parts. That results in these deadly viruses jumping from these animals to humans. And even the starting point of COVID-19 is believed to be a wet market in China where the animals were being kept in such bad conditions in close confinement. They were being slaughtered right in front of each other. And that is when the virus jumped from them to humans. And now it is spreading so fast. And it is spreading even faster in meat processing plants and facilities around the world. We are seeing that people who are working in these facilities where meat is being processed and packaged are at a higher risk of getting COVID-19. And that's not just outside India, it's even true for India, where in Chennai, the meat markets had to be shut down because there were so many COVID cases around the meat market in the area where the meat market was there. So what do we do to fight COVID-19? We boost our immunity. That is the most important thing that we can do. No mask, no sanitizer, nothing can help us if our body is not strong enough to handle this, if we don't boost our immunity. And how do we boost our immunity? By stopping the consumption of meat and other animal products and increasing the consumption of plant-based foods, basically fruits and vegetables, which are so rich in phytonutrients, and they give us all the tools that our body needs to boost our immunity. So we really need to concentrate on that. And we need to get rid of our diabetes. We need to get rid of our hypertension and other lifestyle diseases. because we are seeing that people who have these underlying diseases are at a much higher rate of ending up in an ICU with COVID-19. But people who are otherwise healthy, their body has all the tools to fight with COVID and they don't end up having complications. So we really need to work on getting rid of all these diseases. And we must understand what is the link between meat, protein, and COVID-19. And I hope I've been able to give you a glimpse of that. Animals kept in confinement, when animals are kept in confinement for their meat consumption or for any of their body parts, you know, it results in the onset of pandemics. And when we have meat processing plants or meat packaging plants, it results in higher rate of spread of these pandemics. And when we consume meat, we are also taking in high animal protein. We are taking more than what we need. And it results in lifestyle diseases. And once we have lifestyle diseases, then our body's capability to cope with viruses like COVID drastically reduces. So it's time that we take our health in our hands and we really work on giving the right fuel to our body by consuming more plant-based foods and no meat and no animal-based foods. And I hope I've been able to share some important points with all of you. And I really urge you to make this change, make this positive change in your life. So thank you so much for listening to me, and over to you, Rena.
Thank you. Thank you, Shalu. It's so true that we need to really consider our choices. And like Dr. Neil Murnad said, people who are already having lifestyle diseases are actually more susceptible to having COVID. And eating meat and animal products actually get us to the lifestyle diseases. So it's kind of a circle that we are all caught in. So maybe nature is trying to tell us something. I don't know whether we are listening. So right now, we had Shalu who spoke about the protein, the nutritional aspects as far as meat is concerned. Let's have a look at another aspect of how meat consumption is affecting us and maybe something else that we've never really thought about. So I would like to invite our next speaker, Vinita. Vinita is going to be sharing a different connection as far as meat and us are concerned. So over to you, Vinita. Thank you.
Thank you, Rena. And thank you, Shalu, for those insights that you gave us. It's so true, right, that meat causes a host of diseases and meat also causes pandemics. But there is another important pressing issue that we don't think about so much, which is threatening our very existence, and that is climate change. So I'm going to talk to you more about that in just a minute. Let me tell you about myself first. So I was born into a non-vegetarian family. And as children, we enjoyed eating meat. Just like so many of you have told us that, you know, your parents gave you meat and you didn't even think about, you know, where it came from. In the same way, I too and my siblings, we all enjoyed eating meat. And we never thought about the harm that it was causing us. My mother was diagnosed with diabetes when I was just a teenager. And my sister was diagnosed with cancer at a very young age of 26. She was only 28 when she passed away. And that completely changed my outlook on health. A few years later, I came across Sharan. When I learned about Sharan, I didn't attend any seminars or talks. All I did was did a lot of research. I went through all the work that was available online on Dr. Shah. I went through other plant-based doctors like Dr. Neil Bernard, Dr. Michael Greger, and many, many more. And I just realized that a plant-based lifestyle is the way forward. And I turned vegetarian overnight. Now, I really wish that the information that I have today, I had back then. I could have maybe saved my sister's life. My mother is now diabetes free because of this lifestyle. And that's where my journey to health began. I now feel so much more lighter. I feel energetic. My skin cleared up. I lost weight. and my immunity went up. But most importantly, I made a connection. I made a connection with nature and with animals. Now, I spoke to you about how climate change is such an important issue today, and we've completely ignored it. Our planet Earth, our Mother Nature, she's very sick today. And we have been just ignoring that for far too long. So how does meat consumption cause climate change? Right now, she's very sick, like I said. She has a fever. Her temperatures have been rising at a faster rate in the recent past, because of which we've seen a lot of havoc. We've seen the cyclones these days have a higher intensity. We've seen rainfalls, heavy rainfalls. We've seen droughts. We've seen heat waves. And as the years go by, the intensity of these will keep on increasing as her temperatures rise. It is estimated that we will see entire cities go underwater, which will be a horrid sight. Now, the main reason for her temperatures to rise is, of course, greenhouse gas emissions. Of those greenhouse gas emissions, 13% comes from all transportation combined, which is your trucks, trains, planes, all of those transportation, only 13%. But a big percentage, which is 51%, this is only an estimate, some project even up to 80% of greenhouse emissions come from animal agriculture. So when we breed these animals for food, for dairy, they produce their digestive gases, which is methane, which is released into the atmosphere and causes this heat. Her arteries are clogged. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean her rivers, her oceans have been treated like dumping grounds. One of the biggest polluters is animal waste. We don't realize this, but as humans, we produce about 8 million tons of waste, but animals produce much, much more, about 335 million tons every year. These are all the animals that we breed into existence. All that waste goes into the rivers, poisoning everything along the way and poisoning our oceans. When they go into the oceans, they create something that is called as dead zones. Dead zones are areas in the ocean which have no life left in them. No marine life can survive. If a fish tries to pass that dead zone, they die. There are many such dead zones all over the world. The closest dead zone to us is in the Bay of Bengal. And the size is approximately the size of state of Punjab. That's how big it is. And that is how much harm we've caused to our beautiful oceans. We need our oceans for oxygen. 50% of our oxygen comes from our oceans. She is dehydrated. Now, we all know that water is a scarce resource. And soon, countries will be going at war for water. But I know you all are doing your best to conserve water and to save water, but it's not enough. When we consume animal products, our water footprint is much bigger than when we consume plants, especially fruits and vegetables and millets. These are much lower in water consumption compared to animal foods. Did you know that one egg costs you 200 liters of water, which is quite a lot? Imagine how much you would save if you switch over to plant foods. Her lungs are failing. We need our forests to survive. We need these trees to take in the carbon dioxide and release oxygen for us. It'll be such a dire situation if we have to wear oxygen masks to go out. The main cause of this is deforestation. Did you know that 77% of agricultural land goes to animal agriculture? Right now in India, there are 536 million cattle and bovine animals, again, that are used for meat, for dairy, which are eating into our wildlife sanctuaries. They're eating also into the Himalayas. Of course, all that land is being used up just so that we can enjoy some meat later. The UN has also declared that deforestation is one of the causes of zoonotic diseases because they spill over from the habitats, because we are invading their homes, we are invading the wildlife. When we destroy the forest, we even destroy their homes. And because of which, the pathogens and the viruses that they have get passed on to us through vector animals like mosquitoes. So what is the solution to all of this? We have to change what's on our plate. Every time you decide what you put on your plate, you're either destroying the planet or you're protecting the planet. Make informed choices and make sure that, you know, you do your best you can to save a planet for our children. So we've learned today that meat causes disease, meat causes destruction, and we have to move away from these to a culture of health and protection. But also we've disconnected ourselves from our innate nature of compassion. Now, when I was a child, I had this dog, his name was Jumbo, and he was the best part about my childhood. I have such fond memories with him. He was very playful, very protective of us. Yet in China, dog meat is considered very common. Now you might think to yourself, how cruel is it for someone to eat dog meat, right? But in the end, dog meat looks the same as lamb meat, chicken meat, pork meat, or beef. In the end, an animal just is treated as food, which is so cruel. And we don't even realize that we treat some animals as pets and some animals, we make that differentiation as food. Isn't this lamb so cute? I mean, I used to enjoy eating lamb chops so much, and I never made the connection that where this came from. The day that I saw this photo, I just realized that how similar this lamb looks like to my dog. Lambs are only 6 months old when they are slaughtered. They're very playful animals. And I was crying for days when I realized this. Cows are very motherly. They're very gentle. They enjoy listening to music, but yet they're treated with so much cruelty. First of all, we use her as milking machines just so that we can enjoy some cheese, butter, paneer, ghee. We take away her babies from her. If she gives birth to a son, he's sent to slaughter for meat or for leather. And if she gives birth to a daughter, she has the same fate as her mother, which means she will be made pregnant year after year just so that she can be lactating and pregnant at the same time. In nature, cows can live up to 25 to 26 years, but her lifespan is shortened to a mere 4 years after she's useless to the dairy industry. India is the second largest exporter of beef in the world. We don't eat her meat, but we do sell her flesh. Chickens. Now, I know a lot of people don't even associate chicken with an animal. All we think of is food. But they are such beautiful animals and such intelligent animals. Chickens can recognize up to 100 faces of their own species. They can do simple maths, and they also can communicate with their children in the shell, just like we can communicate with our babies in the womb. Isn't that amazing? But again, her life is just treated like a product, a commodity. We breed them into existence. And as Shalu said, that we inject them with antibiotics and growth hormones. They become so heavy with those growth hormones that they cannot sustain their weight on their legs. And if they try to run, they have a heart attack. Again, in nature, chickens can live up to 10 to 14 years, but her life is cut down to just a mere 40 days. Fish. Now, I know a lot of people don't even look at fish as sentient beings, but they have a sense of community, and we don't realize this, that they're also very highly intelligent. Just because we cannot hear them scream doesn't mean that they don't feel pain. Fish do feel pain, we can see that, and yet we choose to ignore it. What about eggs? Eggs are just the ovulation process of hens. Just like we release an egg every month after our periods, females do that, human females, the same way hens have an ovulation process. And eggs are basically chicken periods. In a year, a hen can lay up to 12 to 15 eggs. But in factory farms today, they are forced to lay 300 eggs, more than 300 eggs. And you can see how her body has become so weak by this constant injustice. What happens to the male chicks in the egg industry? The male chicks are useless to the egg industry because, of course, they cannot lay any eggs. On the first day of life, they are shredded to death. Now, this is common practice worldwide. Switzerland is the only country that has banned this process, and that also very recently in September 2019. Now, imagine you have some chicks and you put them in a blender and blend them up just so that you can enjoy an omelette later. It just doesn't make any sense. Now, like Shalu spoke about instincts, what do you see when I put these two things in front of you? When I showed this to my four-year-old daughter, she said that she would eat the strawberries and play with the chick. She even said that she would take one of the strawberries and offer it to the chick. And that is our innate nature. If you go back to your childhood, you will know that, you know, we never wanted to cause any harm to any being. But over time, we've conditioned ourselves to think that it's okay to eat some animals and to love some animals. Would you kill an animal yourself? Now, when I ask that question to myself, the answer is no. I could not slit the throat of a chicken or stab a lamb. I could not do it. So why would I pay somebody else to do it for me? Another question that I would like to ask, like for you to ask yourselves, is are your taste buds more valuable than an animal's life? That few moments of taste on your tongue, is it worth the entire life of a being? I would highly recommend that you watch these videos, these documentaries and talks. Please take a screenshot or a photo. Please go through them and educate yourselves on how important it is that we understand how it is affecting our planet, how is it affecting our health, and how it is affecting our innate nature. Thank you so much. In the end, I would like to say that the same spark of life that is within you is within all these animals, and they have the same desire to live as much as we do. And I don't think we have the right to take that away from them. Thank you so much. Over to you, Rana.
Thank you, Vinita. I actually had goosebumps, you know, when you were speaking all this. I have some comments coming, people having tears. And somebody shared that earthlings changed their life. So thank you for helping us make that connection, because we really didn't know, it's not our fault. But now the choice is, once we make the connection, what do we do about it? So thank you for sharing that. And now, so till now we have discovered the effect of meat or the impact of meat on our health, on our emotional state as far as us being compassionate is concerned, and the environment, the planet. And now, what about another aspect? See, there is so much that just by what we put in our plate has an effect. So very, very happy to invite Dr. Nandita to shed some light on this. Over to you, Dr. Nandita. Thank you.
Thank you, Reina. And thank you all for being here, and I'm so happy to be able to share this with you. I grew up as a vegetarian, so I'm coming from a little different perspective. And let me share my slides as well. There we go. And I'm going to speak about the psychological and the let me put it this way, spiritual toll of eating meat. You know, when we're young, we're all connected. Like children are connected to the oneness that we all have. And that's why when you look into a child's eye, you see the same innocence that you see in animals. And animals and children are connected. A child could easily put his hand into an animal's mouth because they don't see the difference between themselves and the other. And that's a state that we need to get to when we want to reach a spiritual state, a state of oneness. Now, I was consuming dairy as a vegetarian, and I lived in Canada, and I saw all my friends eating meat. And yet, when my parents told us that we were vegetarian so that we wouldn't harm any animals, I understood it. I didn't want to be like my friends. And I remember going once to a science exhibition and seeing a cow's eye, and I immediately thought about the animal behind it. And it brought a knot to my stomach that how could anyone do this? And I remember going to a Mexican restaurant and ordering an enchilada. And instead of the bean enchilada, a meat enchilada came, and I bit into it. And I just wanted to wash my mouth out because I couldn't imagine putting a dead animal in my mouth. And that was in Canada when all my friends were eating meat, and I accepted that, but I couldn't accept it for myself. But as I grew up and I wanted to go to medical school, the conditioning changed. And you know, as I could accept it in my friends as a child, I started accepting the fact that we had to do frog dissections and other dissections in order to complete our science course and go to medical school. And I was dissecting frogs whose hearts were beating and legs were twitching in a clinical manner without really thinking about them. And, you know, being a vegetarian, I didn't even think about milk being bloodstained. And you already heard about how the calf is taken away from its mother, whether it's a male or a female. If it's a female, she's not given her full quota of milk. And if it's a male, it goes to make veal and calf leather. And I was using calf leather and wasn't making the connection. But when I made the connection, I had become a doctor to reduce suffering. And when I made the connection between dairy and suffering of animals, I knew that I had to make a change. And I did. And I stopped consuming dairy, and this was in the early 1980s. And I saw a huge improvement in my state of health. And I started reading, and I recognized that in medical books, our textbooks, nowhere is it written that milk is good for you. So it's just our myth that has been spread by the dairy and meat industries that we need animal milk or meat for protein. As a vegetarian, I thought that milk was required for protein, but it's not. We can get our protein from the same place that the cow gets hers. So when I recognized this, I started telling my patients, and I saw an amazing result. Results that I couldn't even imagine. You know, cases of diabetes and heart disease reversing in such a short time. Patients who had no hope to ever get free of this were free of this and all their medicines. And I thought that was just so amazing. Then one day I was at a conference in Spain, and I looked for food that I would be happy to eat, and I didn't find anything. Even the salads had eggs and cold cuts on it. And this was a long time ago, because now I assure you that no matter where you go, you can get vegan meals. And so I looked for something that I could eat, and I ended up ordering a plate of French fries, you know. At that time, I wasn't eating completely oil-free. And the French fries came with mayonnaise and ketchup on top. And I had the dilemma of whether to throw out the mayonnaise or eat it, because I had become vegan for the sake of the animals, and I couldn't bring back this chick, right? So I ate it with the mayonnaise on top, and I woke up the next morning with a feeling of anxiety and fear. And I could immediately connect to it because I had felt this anxiety and fear every morning when I woke up as a child, as a young adult. But now it was surprising because as soon as it came back, I realized I hadn't had it for a long time. And this feeling of anxiety did not leave me for 10 days. I didn't make the connection right away. I was wondering what was the cause of this anxiety. And later on, when I got back to India, I realized that, you know, one of my patients said the biggest change is in the state of mind. And I started understanding what was the change in the state of mind for her and recognized that this fear and anxiety was coming through the stress hormones that Shalu talked about in animal products. And even this tiny bit of mayonnaise, this tiny bit of egg that goes into the mayonnaise, I could sense it. Isn't that amazing? And now, if I by mistake eat something which I didn't want to eat, I can sense it immediately the next day, even though I was totally unaware while eating. Now, I researched this and I found that many people wake up in the morning with anxiety or fear. And this is a quote from The Insider. And one of the reasons for this may be just that we are consuming the fear of another being. So cows, pigs, chicken, whether they're egg laying or to eat, they're all subject to a lot of stress because they're living totally unnatural lives, short lives, so that they can become food on our plates. And this is a social injustice issue, don't you think? I mean, we don't really connect the animal injustice to the human injustice, but imagine human trafficking. How is it different from animal trafficking? Because both are beings that want to live a natural and normal life. Or how is rape to a woman different from rape that is routinely accepted in cows so that they'll give birth as soon as possible to keep their milk cycle flowing? Or how is murder different when it's in an animal or in a human being? Or even exploitation for that matter? Because don't you think that to make a cow repeatedly pregnant and then take away her babies so that we can consume her dairy, which is what I was doing, or even take her colostrum, that means her baby hasn't had the first bit of milk. Isn't that an exploitation too? And that's why Dr. Albert Schweitzer said, until he extends the circle of his compassion to all living beings, man will not himself be free. And this is what I noticed in so many of my patients when I spoke to them. They found amazing changes, changes in their state of clarity, more relaxed, less stressed, more grounded, more maturity. Maturity in the sense of, you know, until we actually are grounded, we feel victims. We feel that something is happening to us. And this is happening even in the pandemic right now. We have become victims of the pandemic sometimes. So a greater state of confidence, a greater state of responsibility and contentment, a whole shift in their paradigm. And this is amazing. And, you know, for those of you who haven't experienced it, I highly recommend just 30 days completely animal-free diet and see what it feels like. And now even I can say the biggest change is in the state of mind. And spirituality is oneness. And right now, more than ever, we have to recognize that COVID-19 is forcing us to recognize that oneness, because we are all breathing the same air. We are all breathing the same water. We are all connected, and we have to disconnect ourselves from each other with masks and social distancing. But ultimately, even that cannot avoid COVID-19, right? So So we really need to go to the cause of COVID-19, which is the meat markets, and keeping animals and ourselves in close confinement so that this spreads. And so if we can go back to our original state of oneness with animals, and this child doesn't see the difference because actually we are one. So in summary, Sharan recommends no meat, and that's because it's basically not our food, it's not instinctive to our being. It's full of fat and cholesterol. In fact, only animals produce cholesterol. There's no cholesterol in plants. And so anyone who has excess cholesterol, it's because of either meat or dairy. There's no fiber in meat or dairy for that matter, and we need fiber. We are consuming excess proteins. We don't really need those whey powders or protein powders, and we don't even need animal protein. We can get all the proteins we need just from plants. Meat spreads pandemics. It's ecologically harmful, and we're seeing climate change right now. Of course, it's bad for the animals who want to live and be healthy and pain-free just like we do. And it's psychologically and spiritually harmful to ourselves too. So all these, I believe, are really good reasons to leave meat. And Sharan is committed to building a culture of health, which is more important now than ever before. And we can help people with lifestyle diseases like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and so on, even cancers and autoimmune diseases, reverse disease just through a whole food plant-based diet. And I really recommend that you learn more about us through our website. Like Vinita said, she learned about it and got healthy again. So thank you very much for joining us today on this talk. And Reina, over to you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you for summarizing it and putting it together so that we can actually see it in one shot, that why meat is really not worth it. It's really, really not worth it. So we're